Hi, I'm Kevin from Springfield Leather.
And I'm Rusty from Springfield Leather.
We had this brilliant idea. Well, maybe not a brilliant idea, but we had this idea. We've gotten so much response from the video that we have done on how to buy your first sewing machine that we decided to do step two, which is leather sewing machines for people like us. Or
dummies.
Leather machines for dummies. Now, sewing machines are interesting things, and if you've never owned one, here's usually how it goes. You ready? Gosh, Martha, I'm making so many knives I just can't hardly keep up with the sheaths anymore. I need to get a sewing machine. That way I could make more sheaths faster and we'll make more money. Or holsters, or whatever you want. Well, here's the deal. That might be true. But to start out this video, there's one thing you need to know. It does not matter how much money you spend on a sewing machine, how good it is, how bad it is, what model it is, how dumb you are, or how smart you are. You are going to have problems with your sewing machine. So get used to it. It's just a fact of life. Did I say anything wrong?
No, that was pretty much it. You know what I usually tell people is I ask them to go and get in front of a mirror real quick and to say, you see that guy right there? That's going to be your worst enemy.
Okay, that's true. Now, back to the basics. When you get your sewing machine, especially if it's a heavy stitcher like this one, it's going to come, the chains aren't going to be hooked up, and there's nothing really too critical about that.
Belt won't be on it.
The belt's not going to be on it, but most people are able to figure that stuff out. And it's going to have a piece of leather under the sewing presser foot there that's been stitched on this machine. We do that on purpose. As a matter of fact, anybody that sells a sewing machine is going to have that in there to show you that this machine stitches or has stitched when it left the premises. Now, from that point, you need to make sure you got everything that you're supposed to get when it comes in the machine, or when you get your machine. This particular one, you'll know what you're supposed to get in pretty short order when you buy it. So we're not going to go over all that. But there are some things that you really need to understand. The first thing is how to thread this dumb thing. Why don't we just do that?
Let's just do it. I think we should
make it difficult. You're absolutely right. You want to explain that?
Sure. On a home sewing machine, there'll be this little pin that sticks up. And on that pin, you'll put your little spool of thread and it'll come over and it allows that little spool of thread to turn. Well, this little spool of thread isn't going to turn like that. So it sits on a thread stand, and you absolutely must pull off the top of that thread stand.
It has to.
No ifs, ands, or buts. So first thing you're going to do is come through. You find the eye of that dude right there.
Remember we said for dummies?
Now, the second thing you're going to do is hold on to it and make sure that it does not unravel to where it wraps around the bottom of this. It'll happen, I promise.
Or, not only that, your thread could wrap around underneath here and you won't see it. When that happens, like that, it's not gonna sew. Well, it will.
It'll sew till this is gone.
It'll sew for a minute and then it's done. And it won't sew anymore after that.
And you know, Kevin, what happens too when you don't come through this is, man, it sews beautiful for 8 or 10 inches or even stitches, and then it has to pull that, and then the stitches get real tight, and it pulls it, and then it sews real nice.
And it frays and breaks.
And then we get a phone call. Okay, these thread kind of unique, but every sewing machine has to do the same sort of things. It has to create tension, it has to go through the take-up arm, and it has to come through the take-up spring before it gets to here. Almost all sewing machines will be the same way. The way that this machine creates tension is between these two tension discs. The idea is to keep that thread between those tension discs as long as possible so that you can create as much tension as you want to create. And the way that they've accomplished it is through this eye.
So you went up through that little metal eye there.
And then you pull it down through those discs. It has to be pulled down through there.
Okay, so what you're telling me is if we do this, if somebody runs it around like that, it ain't gonna sew.
It won't sew correctly.
Okay, won't be happy.
It ain't gonna be happy.
That's pretty tight.
It is pretty tight. These things use a lot of tension.
Now remember that, lots of tension.
We're gonna come right back through the same hole.
Okay.
Okay.
So this is complicated then.
And then you pull it tight into there. Now, the next thing is guide your thread. Always hold on to the back side of your thread. We're gonna go through here, and it's gonna do very similar, except it doesn't go between discs. It lays into a V, much like the V of a.
It's like a roller with a V.
With a V. It's like a V in a V. It's gonna wrap around that twice. And then it's going to come back through the exact same hole.
Now that wrapped counterclockwise.
Correct.
And then it's going back up through that
little wire
loop.
And see how I'm holding this? Yeah. And the reason I'm doing that is so that it doesn't end up wrapped up around that handle.
Sewing machines are funny things.
Well, and thread like this too has so much memory in it that those loops will just... And it doesn't just quit stitching for no reason. Something simple happened, and it's always the simple things that get us. Here's your take-up spring, comes up through the take-up spring, up to the take-up arm. Need a little more slack. You want
this, that takes some pressure.
You want this foot up, and that will take some of that pressure off of it.
Oh yeah. Rusty, while we're here, let's just show them that.
Okay.
Go ahead and drop the foot. These tension plates up here keep a lot of tension on this thread. What Rusty said was exactly correct. If you raise the foot, you can see these little tension plates, they split apart a little bit.
Watch this lever right here. See how it's going to move?
It goes up and splits those tension plates. That lets you pull pretty darned easily. Now you can also release that by the foot pedal. And guess what? This is so exciting. You can even raise that foot higher up than you can with that happy little lever. That's why you need to learn to use the foot pedal to raise your presser foot. And that releases the tension just the same. You drop it, the pressure goes back.
All right, now back down here, you've got a spring-loaded plate. This thread doesn't go behind the plate.
It looks like it does.
It goes through the plate. There's a little slot on top of it, and it just rides right through the plate.
So when you pull this out the machine, you can kind of look down in there and see where it goes.
And you've got another guide. You'll go through that happy guide.
So you can either poke it through that loop, or you can just push it into that wire assembly and it'll automatically go in there.
Yep. Then you've got a guide hole at the side of the needle bar. And that's going to keep that thread close to the needle so that it can go through the groove. The groove on the side of the needle on this machine should always be to the left. And that allows this thread to lay up inside that groove.
When it's going
when
down,
it's going
through,
down
the
through the material. And when it starts to come back up. On this particular machine also, we're going to always thread from left to right. You're always going to be going towards the throat.
How many times, Rusty, have we had somebody drive an hour and a half to the store and say, my machine's not sewing. Well, what happened? Oh, I broke a needle. Well, let's see it. The needle's in backwards. I wonder why it won't sew. That's it. What Rusty said was true. That groove has to be on this side. There's a needle cutaway that has to be on the other side.
On this, when you come through, guide it. It'll loop up underneath of that needle, and it's going to be one of those simple things that you just do not see. So, we've threaded the top of the sewing machine.
That's exciting.
We've left the cover off of this
so that you can see down in it.
There's a handle up inside of there that my fat fingers won't hardly hit.
Let's
now
close it once. Let's turn it so that this case is pointing down.
Oh, you're a bad man.
I know that. Okay. I don't know. They probably can't see that little lever, but in the video that comes with the machine, it'll point that little lever out right there, and you just lift it a little bit, and that will allow, I think, maybe it won't. Thank you.
I didn't figure you wanted to use your ink pen to do it.
I don't. That will allow this to swing out and fall out.
Fall being the key.
Yeah.
The reason that I said he was a bad man is because if you open that like that, behind there, in the upright position, you open that, you'll notice that that is spring loaded. If you open that upside down, that spring will fall out. And if you think that dude ain't hard to find, my friend, you are wrong. It is microscopic.
And that spring is really important.
Really is not happy to have to dig it out. You will find also, it doesn't change tremendously the way the machine sews, but it's much, much easier to put a bobbin in if you will have the bobbin coming around to your left side with the thread. Goes in, down, hold the bobbin so that it doesn't move, and pull it down in between those.
Well, that's simple enough.
And
just
click.
In there. You got to click?
Click. If it does not click, it's not going to be happy. Now, once you've got that, hold your thread. Run it around slowly by hand. It will pick up the happy little bobbin thread. And voila.
That's nice. That's just simple. So we can all just sew easily. Now everything's good, right?
Well, everything is happy to a degree.
Do we want to put that plate back on there?
If you put the plate on, if you do not put the plate on, you will be sewing along and your finger will get in there. And it does not necessarily hurt, but boy, it will scare the dickens out of you. So, I would say let's put the plate on.
Okay.
Now.
But you're not going to hurt it leaving it off.
You will not hurt it leaving it off.
Okay.
We're actually going to take it back off here in a little bit and talk about a couple of things when we get into there. Remember, this thing had a lot of tension. So whenever you get ready to sew, you want to make sure that you have enough thread to hold on to, because it will pull that thing right out of your hand. And it'll pull it right back up through. The other thing is if you're not holding on to it, or if it pulls it out and it ends up down inside of there, it will be bad.
Yes.
A piece of thread. This is my favorite thing to do. I don't have any hobbies.
Why'd you cut such a big one?
Because that piece of thread right there. Let's just do this.
No.
This piece of thread laying right there in that raceway will stop this machine dead in its tracks.
Just completely, 100%.
Completely.
You can't turn the wheel.
Cannot.
You can't do nothing.
And if it goes down through here, it'll lock that thing up tight. And the first thing you want to do is go, oh! And then the second thing you want to do is, Kevin, my sewing machine won't sew anymore.
No, don't do that. That's not right. The number to dial is okay. It's Rusty, my sewing machine won't sew. That's, get this right.
Sorry. If you go, and you get it to turn, it'll slip a cam in the back of the sewing machine, and then the sewing machine thinks that it's going backwards, but it's trying to go forwards, and then when you put it in reverse, it's trying to go forwards, but then it's trying to, it's actually,
you know,
going
what?
Backwards.
You're making my head hurt, Gary.
Well,
this is not happy.
The point is if the sewing machine stops.
How do you get that out of there?
Well, if the sewing machine stops, you lift your presser foot and you cut every piece of thread you can reach. And you take this thing out.
Okay.
Once you have that out, you take these two screws. And once you get those two screws out, you don't lose them.
All of that is able to come off.
You put a flat screwdriver behind either side, and very gently you pull this out and make sure this doesn't fall to the floor.
Because that would be bad.
It'd be bad. that piece of thread will just come right out of there, and you put it all back together, and it will sew. If you strong arm it, you will have an hour and a half, 2 hour trip to come and visit with Kevin. Got it. Don't do that either. Don't ever run around with the thread, with the needle threaded.
Yeah, if you make a couple of revolutions with no material in there, you'll get a happy little wad of thread in there, and it's
still tying knots.
Yeah, I mean, you can cut it, pull it all out, but it's just a pain in the, it's a pain.
Keep this clean. It's going to get a lot of lint. It's going to get a lot of, just blow it out with a can of air or something. I usually will put a drop of oil in it too.
Yeah, after a couple of years of pretty good use, even the dust buildup from that thread can cause the machine to do exactly what Rusty said. Stop.
Just stops. And it's so funny because it's so simple to avoid, but the first thing all of us want to do is give that thing a tug, and just don't. Well, so anyway, so do you want to sew something?
Scares the dickens out of you here. I have leather.
Yes, I love leather. I think we should start at some point with the roller edge guide, don't you?
Yes.
This is standard to, and should be standard to any heavy stitcher that you've got. Basically, this is a roller edge guide. This creates a guide that you can just, as long as your edge is clean on your material, it's gonna just follow that and make you look like a professional.
A professional? That's a new word.
The distance between your roller edge guide and your needle is going to determine how far in your stitching is, okay? And so once you decide where you like it, or you think you've decided where you like it, just set it in there and kind of run it down and see if it's really what you want. Get it set up.
In other words, put your needle right down there where you think you want to sew.
Right, and you maybe even touch it and pull it out, and you'll be able to see. And if that's what you like, then that's fine. You tighten this up, and I'll tell you, to be honest with you, I use a small pair of channel locks and just get a hold of that thing and tighten it up, because really what you want is you want it good and tight, and you don't want it to begin to move away from you as
you're
sewing.
If you're sewing a belt or something, you don't want to be halfway down and realize that your edge guide slid over an eighth of an inch, because that's not fun.
Not happy. This will still swing out of the way to give you some room, or it's just, I like, undo it and just slide it off the end. But we're going to say that we like that.
Is that locked in there?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think.
Oh, when you sew, make sure.
Hold on to that dude.
Hold on to those threads. You don't have to hold on to it like you're trying to haul in a catfish, but you want to hold on to it pretty snug. Wouldn't you say?
I like the catfish aspect of it. Servo motor on a sewing machine is, the way that I refer to it, a beautiful thing. Hmm. Because it does not matter how fast or slow you are sewing. With a servo motor and a speed reducer, it will just push it right through there. Once you've made about 3 or 4 stitches, you can let go of the thread. It's not that important at that point.
But if you don't hold the thread when you start, you know what's going to happen.
Well, I know what's going to happen.
You're going to end up with thread down in that.
You're going to get a phone call.
Thing, and it's going to be messy, and you're going to, it pulls out of your hand, and it's all because you didn't pull enough thread out of here to start with. You got too cheap, and you didn't want to waste a bunch of thread, so you just left a little bit here, and you take one revolution, and that thread goes ka-pink out of your hand down inside of there, and it wraps around 14 different things, and it makes a mess.
Pretty close.
That's the way it works.
That's now, nice. The one thing that I didn't do is I didn't lock the stitch. And so, in other words, locking the stitch basically means that I don't have to do anything to that. It's done.
We can do that.
Well, I was actually going to sew around it. That's what I thought I'd do.
You got enough thread?
Yeah. Sure.
In the bobbin?
Yeah. Totally. You're gonna find out that locking the stitch in a heavy material, in a heavy thread, is better if you can start in about half or 3/4 of an inch and back
up. So backwards and then forward.
And then forward, because if you come forward, backwards, and forwards, you actually end up with a bunch of knots back here, and it's not happy. It's not pretty.
Makes total sense.
Totally. Okay. We're gonna cheat real quick and.
The is not leather machines for people who want to learn how to sing.
You ruin everything. Okay, before you get back to this, this is a for instance that you're going to sew around something. Before you get back to this, cut these two pieces of thread off.
And why in heaven's name gone. Would you want to do that?
Because now they're not going to get in here and gum up the works.
Yep.
All right, so we're going to sew, and let's say that I'm sewing all the way around this. I'm going to get to a point where this stitch is going to either, I want to end up in this hole. So this stitch is either going to be long or short. So I've got a decision to make.
So you raise up the foot.
I've got the foot raised up.
You put the needle where you want it.
Put the needle right where you want it.
You got to drop the foot, because if you don't, it's not going to make the stitch.
Make the stitch.
Then you raise the foot, make sure it's exactly where you want it.
And put it right in that
right in that hole.
First hole.
There you are. And now you are happily shoveled.
And it will sew right back into its own holes, and the stitch is therefore locked.
Now why'd you pull out the thread up there?
Because if you pull out the thread up here, then you're not pulling against the needle, potentially bending the needle.
So I can pull out thread.
As long as, yeah, see, and if I've got my foot on there, it makes it all the more easy. Now don't touch that. Be very cautious.
So now you can flip your little burner thing out.
Flip
and burn
your little burner thing out, burn it. Beautiful.
That is very good looking.
Thank you.
That's a really thin piece of leather.
It is thin. And in actuality, for this heavy of a stitcher, this is about as thin of leather as you're going to want to sew. The thickness of the leather is important because of hiding the knot, but the firmness of the leather is important because the amount of tension this thing uses, it will wad thin leather up just like a ball. Now, the wonderful part of this, though, is that it is a compound walking foot with a needle feed.
Well, that's exciting.
It is exciting, especially when you can do this. And step right up onto it.
Oh, look at that. Pretty cool.
And when you can sew real slow like that, it makes you look like a professional.
Yeah. So, how do you make it go backwards?
Reverse.
You can put it in reverse any old time?
You know, your best bet is to put it in reverse when the stitch is complete, which is an opportune lead into when is a stitch started and when is a stitch complete. Stitch starts when the needle travels down and begins to come back up. The relief that Kevin mentioned is called a scarf, or whatever he said. That scarf has the eye of the needle at the base of it. On the left-hand side of that scarf is the groove that we referred to.
So in other words, all needles have a little cutaway place in them.
Yes.
Just a little half-moon type cutaway thing. That's called a scarf.
It's called a scarf. With that cutaway, what that allows you to do is that allows the loop to begin in a certain spot. If this groove was not on this side, the material in the needle would go down through and it would come up and the loop would create over here or create over there, it'd create wherever it wants, so it wouldn't stitch. It might stitch sometimes.
Right, but now this way it comes up on the same side every time. And that happy little hook that's coming
around
can snag the loop every single time and never fail.
And the interesting part about a hook on a sewing machine...
Hey, you know what could make that fail?
If the needle was twisted.
If the needle is twisted a little bit, one way or another, that could do it. Or, if when you break your dumb needle and you replace it, you don't get it all the way up in there, that would be bad.
That would do it. Scarf, loop creates, thread exits the material. Hook on here is not shaped like this, it's shaped like this. And that allows it to go inside that scarf just a little bit, and that loop creates off of the eye, and it picks it up.
So you're talking millimeters here.
Millimeters.
Small millimeters.
Very small millimeters. So, the stitch is started when the needle goes all the way down and starts to come back up. It is started at that point. The stitch is not complete until it travels all the way up and starts back down. Then the stitch is complete. So, what does it have to do with the 9-degree turn?
Turning your leather 90 degrees.
All right, I'm glad you asked. So, when the needle is in the material all the way down and started back up, you can push your presser foot down, make a 90-degree turn, and continue sewing. and you will have a happy little stitch right there. If the needle does not go all the way down, start back up and begin the stitch, you're going to have a hole there.
You're going to skip a stitch.
But you're going to have a piece of thread that runs from here to here.
Yeah.
You're not going to have a piece of thread from there to there. So you will have missed a stitch. So a 90 degree turn,
I think
needle all the way down, start it back up.
I've missed a lot of stitches.
Well, the beautiful part of it too, remember, is if you were to pull this out when the needle is traveling up and you were just to lift your presser foot and pull it out, you're going to have like 3 or 4 pieces of thread down there.
When you pull that out of there at the wrong time, it looks like you have 4 threads.
Yes.
How can that possibly be?
Because the thread has not gone down and completed the
loop. So you're seeing a loop, which is...
And you have increased the loop size now. And so when that needle...
So you're pulling out a great big loop, which looks like 2 threads.
Yeah.
And then you... Yeah. All right.
And so you pull that out. If you'll just rotate that on around, it'll finish the stitch. Loop goes away.
So another smart thing... Here's another smart thing. If you're going to sew with this thread on the top and bottom, you'd be pretty smart if you'd have 2 rolls of this thread.
Good
because
call.
That way, you never have to rethread the machine.
Good
you can
call.
Have your other roll coming up off of here and down to the bobbin winder.
That's a good call. Because it stinks having to cut the thread rethread the machine.
And people think, I don't want to spend another extra $20 for that roll of thread. Well, my goodness. Yes, you do. You really do.
You really do. You just don't know it. I don't know. I can't think of anything other than, you know, in oiling them, I tell people, you know, all the red dots, oil the red dots. But this right here, that dude goes up and down with every single stitch. So I put a drop of oil right in there, too, just to make sure that those brass sleeves stay in good shape.
I've always oiled this stuff, too. I mean,
there's a couple of holes back
right there
here.
And here. Anything that moves, just put a little
drop of oil in. You know what's smart is I had somebody tell me that they always...
Actually, I don't know what's smart, because if I did, I wouldn't be selling these stupid sewing machines. I can tell you that right now.
Any sewing machine. What's smart is somebody told me the other day, you know, they always oil their machine after they've sewn. And then that way, when they come to it, all the oil has saturated and has oiled the machine. I thought, well, that's kind of smart.
Hmm. Yeah, makes sense. By the way, use sewing machine oil. Don't use that stuff that Uncle Jake had left over from his 1940 Evinrude boat motor.
Do you know what oil looks like? Sewing machine oil is clear.
Yeah.
Do you know what it looks like after it's gotten moisture in it?
No.
It becomes an amber color.
Oh, that would explain a lot.
Right. And once you've started putting an amber colored oil in, you're introducing moisture into the...
That's not happy. So this is why... The oil that comes with these machines, and this is why the oil that we sell is referred to as stainless oil. So when it gets on your leather, it won't stain
it. It's stainless.
And it's oil. It's kind of good. At some point in time, the most dreaded thing in the world happens. You run out of bobbin thread. What do we do?
Da-da-da-dun. Well, for one thing, said bobbin.
Set bobbin.
Has a little hole right here.
Now that's cute.
It's very important. This bobbin winder.
This is a fancy gizmo here.
Well, this bobbin winder,
ooh, this is
quote unquote gizmo, has a pin on it right there. This bobbin winder is different than a bobbin winder on most flatbed sewing machines. And most often the one on the flatbed sewing machine is not real happy with it because it doesn't hold it in the right spot. So we're going to match hole to peg, and that will keep it from spinning when it's on the plate.
Hmm. Now,
remember,
this is the reason why you have 2 spools of thread. We can't just, can we just go down?
Nope, won't turn it, won't wind it.
Well, so I suppose, is this complicated?
Okay. Not traumatically.
I'm going to just, traumatically. You know, since that thing is sticking up high with a hole in it, I'm going to go through that.
I would.
That makes sense. Then I'm going to stick it down in between those tension plates.
Do you know why you want tension on the bobbin winder?
So why is the bobbin tight? I don't know.
Right.
Okay, this seems pretty generic enough.
I like to cheat. There's a hole on either side of the bobbin.
That's really handy.
It is extremely handy. Okay. Now, first thing, Once you're actually ready to wind the bobbin, pull the thread out of the sewing machine if that's all you're doing is winding a bobbin. Lift the presser foot if all you're doing is winding a bobbin.
So if the bobbin winder is too far forward, then this belt has a tendency to slip off one side or another, and that's not very happy.
Correct.
If it's too far back, then it doesn't have enough pressure on this happy little wheel to turn it, and you ain't going to wind your thread. So
correct.
We move the bobbin wheel, the bobbin winder back a little bit, so hopefully it's got the correct amount of thread.
And you don't need a tremendous amount of tension. You just want a little bit of tension.
Just enough to keep it tight. We've got the happy little bobbin winder set up and ready to go. Now there's a piece of information here that you probably don't want to hear, and I don't really want to tell you, but it's the truth. Rusty mentioned it a minute ago, which you may or may not have heard. Most bobbin winders are crappy. Most bobbin winders really don't work all that well. I'm sorry. They put them on a $2,000 to $3,000 sewing machine, and they're okay. They work kind of, sort of, pretty much most of the time, but they need a little bit of attention usually. Just letting you know. So we need to wind bobbin. What do we want to watch for? First off, we want to get it started correctly.
Correct.
So this usually it takes four people to wind a bobbin. But Rusty and I are very talented, so just we're gonna try to do it with just us two.
This is all we got.
So he's gonna start it. I'm gonna hold my finger on this thread so that it will start actually winding the bobbin. So go ahead. Okay. It's going very happily. That's nice. I'm kind of hanging on to it. Now we're gonna watch. And I'm gonna make sure that this keeps winding nicely.
That thing needs to travel. That thread should travel back and forth.
Why don't you stop it now? Then we're gonna cut that off so I don't have to do that anymore. I'm gonna put a little more tension on this just because I love tension. Okay, let's wind away. See how we do. First time you wind a bobbin, you want to, well, there's a reason you pay attention the first time you wind a bobbin, because you find out if your bobbin winder is going to really work or not. Most of them do, but some of them require a little bit of help. Sometimes this thread will start to build up in a lump, and you can kind of help it back and forth. But this winder has a little, see, like that?
Ideally, you want it to be smooth.
This winder has a happy little lever that serves as a disengage. And you'll see what I mean here in just a second. I'm kind of helping it wind a little bit. It's going to reach a point, I hope, where it disengages the bobbin winder. I'm not sure it will. Let me check this. Ooh, it clipped right
see it?
Out. I got it. This little bobbin winder has a little bitty lever down here. And it actually is designed to press up against the thread when the bobbin becomes full up to a point. This one, the bobbin is full enough right now and it has not kicked it off. So what I'm going to do is loosen this, I think. Maybe I won't. You realize, there we go. Okay, we're loosening this little screw. That's good. That lets this lever come up so that it automatically kicks it out like that when the bobbin gets full. So that's part of adjusting your bobbin winder when you wind your first bobbin. You have to do that. It's not going to come set up correctly unless you get lucky. Nobody ever gets lucky. Well, I don't.
I got one thing I'd like to show you on this end as you're winding a bobbin, so I'd be happy to turn the sewing machine. If you're not sewing, you do not want this thread through the needle. But remember what we said about all this memory in this thread?
Oh yeah.
Watch right here as I wind this bobbin. I'm pretending to wind a bobbin. See how much loop it makes? and how it lets that loop just slack.
That's a good point, because that loop wouldn't take much to do that.
And then
you're not gonna know it, because you can still keep going.
Yeah, oh, it'll wind bobbin.
See, they're just fine. But it's someplace it shouldn't be.
And when you go to sew, it's not gonna sew.
At all, happily ever.
So I always, if I'm just winding a bobbin, I just keep a little bit of tension on it so that I can feel it jerking against my finger when the take-up arm tops out.
But this is why it is smart to have this second roll of thread winding your bobbin while you sew.
Because what'll happen is you'll sew a little and it'll wind a little. And you'll sew a little more and it'll wind a little more. And it'll wind a bobbin faster than you can use
the bobbin. Can do a job. So that time when your bobbin runs out of thread, there you go. You put it on there, put a new one on there, get it ready to wind and go happily down the road, or whatever fashion you choose to go down the road. This thing here, everybody wonders what that is.
Are you going to leave us wondering?
Well, it's a little barrel nut thing, tightener pressure thing.
The answer to my question was yes. He's going to leave us in the dark.
It's got a happy little washer on the bottom of it, so you can turn it, and then you can play with it.
Totally.
In actuality, this controls the amount of pressure, downward pressure, on your presser feet, your outside presser foot. That can be important because there is a happening that is known as flagging that can occur.
Most times I would think you were telling a story, but this one I believe.
Would you like to explain flagging to them? You do it better than I do.
When the needle begins to travel out of the material, it'll have a tendency to drag on it.
Especially on sticky leather.
Yeah. And when it does, it'll put extra pressure on this foot. And so it wants to move it. Well, if the entire piece of material moves, then the loop isn't created in the right spot. Or the loop isn't even there. And so it'll skip the stitch. So if you don't have enough presser foot pressure on it, the material can move up and down or cause this outside foot to move up and down.
And it's really funny because I've learned that when these machines come in, there's typically about a half an inch here between the locking washer and the top of this barrel. That's about right. And I've seen thin leather, but it's of such a unique type of leather that it's so sticky that needle wants to, it really pulls hard and it pulls that, it actually forces that foot up like Rusty said. And when it does that, you ain't gonna sew. I mean, it'll sew, but it won't sew.
Well, it may not sew, though. Well, the other thing is with thin material, there's a tendency or the possibility that it may flag just because the material itself moved, the material didn't stay put.
Yeah, that's why these are called heavy stitchers.
Not because they weigh a ton, other than the fact that they weigh a ton.
They're meant to sew heavy leather. So when you're sewing three layers of saddle skirting, or four, and you're up to around 3/4 inch, and one of those layers is saddle skirting from World War II vintage, and it's sticky and dry and tough, and you wonder why it's squeaking like a scalded mouse, you know what the problem is.
I have never heard that.
Well, you don't, it can happen. That can lift that foot right up because of that tremendous power that needle has when it's coming up. It drags it up, your leather starts to flag, it does bad things with the loop situation down here, and you're not sewing.
If you are a perfectionist, which we seem to attract.
To start with, if you're a perfectionist, call Rusty. I'm sorry.
If you're a perfectionist,
why did you do that?
Well, because I'm gonna explain something. You can back off the presser foot pressure to a certain point, but what you may find on some leather, like a Horween or an oily leather, a Latigo, is that foot might leave more of an impression than you want.
Little track there.
Little track. It is going to leave a track of some sort. It is going to happen to some degree. But you can back this off by loosening that lock nut and back it off to a certain degree to where you're going to have to draw balance. And you're going to have to say, I can live with this, and that's enough because now it won't sew. or you can run it down. Whatever you end up doing, when you get it where you want it, run the lock nut down. It's not there for decoration or to play with. Run the lock nut down and run it down tight, and then hopefully leave it be.
Yeah, leave it be. I like that thought a lot about leaving it be. So what you're telling me is my machine is not defective if it's leaving a little mark. No. The feet are not defective if it's leaving a little mark.
And the faster you sew, the harder this foot hits, the more of an impression it will leave.
Especially if your leather's damp.
If your leather's moist at all, yeah, you're going to have a nice line. But the faster you sew, the more of an impression that can make too.
So what can you do to hurt this thing? I mean, I've broken needles on here, and when you break a needle, it sounds like something has exploded somewhere close by. And it's pretty scary.
Pretty much.
Bang!
Yeah. Machine rocks.
Yeah. But I've always just put a new needle in and kept on sewing, and it seems to do fine, other than if you make a burr or something, you gotta get rid of that burr, because that's not happy. But to hurt this machine, what do you gotta do?
One is you could open it up and put like a torch inside of it and a drill bit. Needless to say, that voids the warranty. I've had that happen.
Ooh, how about a screwdriver if we get in there and start?
Yeah, that pretty much does it. The other thing you could do is like drop it. I've had them drop downstairs.
What's the most common thing I found is that people are gonna, and you can't help this, somebody's gonna sew and they're gonna break a needle and they're gonna throw that machine out of time. What do you do?
What do I do?
No, what does somebody that owns the machine do?
Well, the first thing they should do is call.
That's right. No, they don't call me. I don't even know how to time this. I purposely did not learn how to time.
He purposely forgot how to get to that point. They make a phone call. I would so much rather talk to you about retiming your machine than to have to tell you that unfortunately you voided the warranty by doing something you shouldn't have done.
We don't want you to void the warranty. These things are practically indestructible. The only thing you can do to this to really hurt it, aside from your blowtorch and metal bar thing, if you drop it, if you tip this over and drop it, it's probably not going to be good.
If you're, like, I don't know, packing it downstairs or upstairs or something and you drop it, we've had them dropped and it shoves the entire shaft over, bad deal, bad day. Has to ship it somewhere to have it fixed, not happy.
Which, you know, just as a matter of course, being as how this is an instructional factoidal video dedicated to a certain quality of individual, such as ourselves, it might be wise to save the box and the packing.
At least for a while.
Like 6 months or a year. Most houses have an attic or barn or someplace or rent a storage unit and save your box. I don't know. But that's a pretty smart thing.
Yeah, because if you do have to ship it back, these things, you know, you're not going to tear it up, but you can knock it out of whack pretty good. And it becomes challenging to explain to someone over the phone that when you received it in a pretty bad shape, possibly worse shape than they sent it. You know, UPS, they're good people. And the people who do those sort of things, they're good people, but they don't necessarily always know how fragile it is inside the box.
What about this motor thing that makes it go? Now, do we want to have, if somebody has an issue, those aren't that difficult, are they? They get directions. Directions are relatively simple on that. You just have to read them carefully. Let's see.
You know, about the only thing you can do to that motor is stomp on the pedal. When you stomp on the pedal, it affects that lever, and there's a laser eye in there, and it's just not, I don't know, the machine didn't do anything, don't stomp on it.
Okay. Well, let's see. Are we missing anything?
I'm sure. We're here, we're doing this, I'm sure we're missing something.
Well, let's call it good.
So we've got like 10 minutes left on this.
If you have an issue, call us.
Please.
Try for Rusty or Bobby, and I can maybe help if it's not too complicated.
And if you even think you want to buy one of these, call us.
We're here.
Let's find out what you're making, and let's find out if this is the right machine for you.
Yeah, because in all reality, and this may sound funny, but we don't make a lot of money on sewing machines, and sewing machines are a lot of grief, hence this video. It's our sincere effort to relieve ourselves of some grief associated with sewing machines.
Are you saying this is totally selfish?
Not totally. I'd like people to be able to fix some, avoid the hassles for themselves. Because when I bought a sewing machine, my first one, I knew I was, boy, I made you look smart. I was, oh my stars, I was dumb. And I couldn't fix one. I knew nothing. It was miserable. It was terrible. It was horrible. And I had the wrong machine. I bought like three machines, all the wrong ones. And then finally, I bought a new one. And some guy was willing to show me how to use it. Well, that took care of the whole problem.
Somebody would have just shown you how to use it in the first place.
So as far as I'm concerned, if you call us, we'll tell you what machine that you want or should use. And we'll try to convince you that we have a good machine for you, maybe. But if we don't, we're not going to try to convince you. And if you find a used one out in somebody's barn and you just think it's the best thing since pockets on a shirt, call us. We'll tell you. We probably have had some experience with that machine. And we'll tell you if it'll do what you want. But when you buy one and get it right the first time, we settled on these because we like them.
That's all I got.
Me too.
See you.
Bye.
Now we're recording. Hi, I'm Kevin from Springfield Leather, and I'm Rusty from Springfield Leather. We had this brilliant idea. Well, maybe not a brilliant idea, but we had this idea. We've gotten so much response from the video that we have done on how to buy your first sewing machine that we decided to do step two, which is leather sewing machines for people like us, or leather machines for dummies. Piece of thread. This is my favorite thing to do. I don't have any hobbies. Why'd you cut such a big one? Because that piece of thread right there. Let's just do this. No. This piece of thread laying right there in that raceway will stop this machine dead in its tracks.
Just completely, 100%.
It can't turn the wheel. You can't do nothing.
And if it goes down through here, it'll lock that thing up tight. And the first thing you want to do is go, ugh! And then the second thing you want to do is, Kevin, my sewing machine won't sew anymore.
No, don't do that. That's not right. The number to dial is okay. Rusty, my sewing machine won't sew. That's... Get this right.
Sorry. And the interesting part about a hook on a sewing machine...
Hey, you know what can make that fail?
If the needle is twisted.
If the needle is twisted a little bit, one way or another, that could do it. Or, if when you break your dumb needle, and you replace it, you don't get it all the way up in there, oh, that would be
bad.
That would do it. Scarf, loop creates, thread exits the material. Hook on here is not shaped like this, it's shaped like this. And that allows it to go inside that scarf just a little bit, and that loop creates off of the eye, and it picks it up.
So you're talking millimeters.
Millimeters.
Small millimeters.
Very small millimeters. When that hook enters that loop, the stitch has begun. That happens when the needle has traveled down and begun back up. Okay, that's so when the stitch is started.
So what does that have to do with making a right turn?
The message is complete.
What did I say? No. The cameraman can't talk back. So, this is for dummies. We got this.
Now they're going to wind. I can hang on to this. Oh, look at that. It's going. Well, look at that. That's pretty happy. Oh, this thing really is. That's not happy.
That wasn't very pretty.
I don't know what happened there.
It got stuck on one edge and then it popped.
Oh. Okay. Let's wind it anyway. It'll work. Maybe we should unwind this one.
Have you ever sewn with a bobbin wound?
Yeah,
like
it doesn't
that?
Work.
I kind of got that real close up on video. You can like explode.
Yeah, it doesn't work. It's not happy.
Don't do that.
Do not do this. Oh, man. I love making videos.
You don't realize how good we're doing.
Remember the part where he said, don't be a tightwad, just pull the thread out?